Yes, what is scenario? Anyone? In previous class we have discussed, right, in sequence diagram. So what is scenario? Rajeshwari? So a scenario is nothing but a sequence of events that are represented in a sentences, right? We are trying to use these scenarios to represent the sequence diagram. Whatever the events are there, those events will be taken in a form of a message, and we are trying to indicate the communication between objects. So that is what we are doing. That is what we are doing with respect to the sequence diagram. And with respect to the activity diagram, we are observing how the flow of events is going to happen. Say for example, once a user logs in into the system, then what he can do? Say for example, the user want to check a mail. What is the first step? He will give his credentials. So once the credentials are verified, then he will log in into the system. After logging into the system, what he is going to do? He is going to check the inboxes, or he is going to compose a mail, delete a mail. So whatever the actions are there, he is going to consider. So that is how we are representing the in a form of a sequence. So these sequences can also be represented in a activity diagram, where we are representing the flow of events from one event to another event, where we are going to call it as a action. So these are the things that we have discussed in a chapter 7, that is a basic representation of how to write a use case diagram. So what are the guidelines that are used to represent a use case diagram, and how to draw the sequence diagram, the guidelines for writing the sequence diagram, and the activity, what is an activity diagram, and what are the different notations that we are trying to represent with respect to the activity diagram. So in a next chapter, we are going to deal with how we are going to deal with these use case diagram or a sequence diagram or a activity diagram with the advanced state. So when we are using a advanced modeling, advanced state. So here what happens? Can you see the diagram, Word document?
No, ma'am.
I have shared. Just wait, just coming. Okay, so next topic, next in chapter 8, we are dealing with the advanced interaction modeling. That is, in a chapter 7 or in a interaction modeling, just we learned what are the different notations of a use case, what is an actor, what is a use case, what is a object, how the objects are represented with respect to the sequence diagram, what is a timeline, and how within a stipulated time, how the objects are going to interact, and how to represent the activities. Those things we have dealt with just a basic interaction modeling. So in advanced interaction modeling, we have a use case relationship. So what is this use case relationship? Sometimes we have to represent a complex diagram. To represent complex diagram, what we have a individual smaller piece of code or smaller piece of information which has to be represented. So what are these information? It can be a include, extend, and a generalization. So what is this? We are going to use all these three different types of relationship to represent the use cases and to build a complex use case system. So first we have a include relationship. In an include relationship, what happens? We are trying to incorporate the behavior of one use case within another. Say for example, if you want to make, say you have a Flipkart application, okay? Can you purchase without having a customer login? You have an online shopping shopping cart, okay? Now answer to me, can you without login or without your account, can you make a purchase? Anyone? Winnie? Can you represent? Answer to my question, anyone? Okay, so here what happens? As I said, we have an example of a Flipkart. So you cannot take, you have a your account. So within your account, whatever the transaction that you are performing, all the transaction is available in your account. So without having an account, you cannot observe or you cannot view what transaction has been done so far. So here what happens? This transaction, customer transaction, is being included within the account. So to have that, when a customer want to have an account, it should be a secured account. So similarly, here we are using the include behavior where one use case can include the another use case. So when we are using this include, when we are trying to use a include relationship, it acts like a subroutine. So what is a subroutine? It is a just one more functionality which is written, right? So when you have written a code, what happens? It will start executing. So when it comes to the subroutine name, okay. So what happens? It will transfer the control to the subroutine. It will execute all the instruction and it will come back. So similarly, here what happens when we are using a concept of include in a system? Here what happens? It will go. It will execute or it will take. It will execute that particular use case within that use case. So how do we represent the UML notation for a include relationship? So we are using the annotations, that is a double arrow mark. Okay, you can see here. Within that, you need to use a keyword include with a arrow denoted. So above the arrow, we need to write a include. So this is how we are trying to represent a UML notation for a include. Here we have an example of a stock brokerage system. When a customer want to purchase a stock, so first what happens? The customer has to have a secure session. To have a secure session, what happens? He need to log in into the system. When he is trying to log in into the system, his credential, his password has to be validated. Here you can see there is a secure session has a use case. Make trade has a use case and validate password has a use case. So here what happens? This secured session includes a password. That means once the session is being included, so what happens? It will validate the customer password. Now after validating the password, so here the customer can make a trade. To make a particular trade, okay, so first the customer has to log in. So for that, what happens? The whatever the credentials that the customer has given, this password will be validated. So this is how we are representing the include. That means what? This validate password is a use case which is being included in a secure session and a make trade. That means when the customer is performing a transaction of a trading to purchase a stock or to sell a stock, so first his credentials will be validated. So that is what the meaning of using the include. Next, we have a extend relationship. So when we have a extend relationship, that means it is similar, it is an incremental or an added behavior to the use case. It is similar to what we have discussed about the include, but we need to look it in a opposite direction. So the UML notation for a extend is similar to the include relationship, where we are representing with respect to the arrow. Above the arrow, we are using the keyword with the annotation extend. Here we have taken an example of a stock brokerage system. Okay, so here trade stocks is one particular use case, margin trading is one more use case, short sale is a one more use case, limit order and the trade options are the other use cases. So to make a stock trading, okay, so the is being extended to the marginal trading. So if you want to make a trading, so this short sale is being extended with respect to the trade stock. That means what? He cannot sell all his stocks. So there is a limitation of order. So how the limit order will be taken care? So with the trading option, see, if a customer is having a 10 shares, so 50% or more than 50% of his stocks can be sold at a time. So that is how we are going to use a extend relationship. So next we have a use case generalization. So with respect to the use case generalization, we know that generalization is nothing but the inheritance or a it is a property where we are trying to take from a parent class. So similarly here, can we use a generalization for a use case? Yes, of course, we can use a generalization for a particular use case. Here, what happens when we are trying to use a generalization with respect to the use case? We are trying to represent how the behavior of a use case is being represented. So what does the child use case is going to carry out with respect to the parental use cases? So how do we refine our steps? So how do we add a particular steps and how the concept can be represented with respect to the use case generalization? The UML notation for a use case generalization is a arrow with its child, that is with a triangular head, triangular arrow head. That is the same way as we have represented in a class modeling. In a class modeling, we have used a generalization notation. The same generalization notation can be used for a use case generalization. Okay, so here you can see here there are two different actors. Okay, one is a customer and one is a security exchange. Here what happens, the we have seen a different include and extend relationship, right? So in we have a use case called as a secure session. So this secure session is being associated with the customer. The customer want to establish a secure session to make a transaction. So this secure session includes a managing of account. That means when a customer locks in, so this section is going to manage all the customer accounts. So with respect to the credentials and with respect to the stock, whatever is there, so that will be taken care inside a secured session. Next, what we have a make trade. So this make trade is being included in a secured session. That means, so So only when the customer has logged in, then only he can perform a trade. So without his login credentials or without a secure session, a customer cannot make a trading. Next, what we have? We have a validate password. It is a use case which has been included in a secured session. Here what happens? So this secure session includes a validate password. Okay. So once the password is validated, so what happens? The customer will log in into the system. Once the customer gets login into the system, then what happens? He can perform a trade. So to perform this trade, it has it is not a one-sided system, right? So all the transactions should happen between the two parties. So the third part, the one more party, what we call it, has a security exchange. So this make trade is being associated with the security exchange. So that is a system. So with respect to that particular system, this customer is making a transaction. Now what happens when a customer is trying to perform a when he is going to perform a transaction, he has a different types of types of transaction that can be made with respect to the trading. So one is trade bond, one is a trade stop, trade options, and limit order. So this limit order is an extension of a make trade. Okay. So while making a trade, he can purchase only with respect to the minimum minimum stocks. That means there is a stock limitation when the customer is trying to make a purchase. So that is the reason this make trade extends to the limit order. So once the limit crosses, again the customer cannot make a trade, or he cannot buy or sell the stocks. So here you can see this trade bonds, trade stock, and trade option is a child use case of a make trade. So why these are called as a, these are called or these are notated, these are represented as a child use cases, because here what happens in a trade bond, it extends a marginal trading. That means whatever the trading that a customer has performed, so within that particular trading trading option, he is going to make he is going to buy or sell the stock, and once he sells the stocks, he has its each and every stock has its own representations, its own limitations, and its own condition. So that he has to bound to that particular condition. So the trading bond will be taken care. Next thing is this marginal trading is being extend this
Hello,
stock trade. Yes.
No, ma'am, I'm Sunil.
One second. Yeah.
Ma'am, so many people waiting outside. Let me accept the request, ma'am.
Okay. No, just I was in. Any other? Okay. Okay, so here what happens? When it comes to the trade stock, it extends to the short sale. What is that short sale? Say customer is having a 10 around 50 shares. So what he can do at that particular moment, he can make he can have a limitations to sell that particular stocks. So at particular period of time, he will make a selling of those stocks. So that is what we call it as a short sale. So this short sale is being extended from a trade stock. Next is a trading option. So trading options can be either a customer can purchase, he can buy the stocks or he can sell the stocks. So this will be taken with respect to the making trade. So that is how we are representing the use case generalization. That means what? In an advanced concept of use case, we can either use a smaller piece of information to represent the complex system with respect to the include, extend, or a generalization. So these are the three concepts that are very much necessary for representing the complex use case diagram. So when we are representing a use case relationship, we need to have a look some guidelines. So what are these guidelines? Listen everyone, when we are the question can be like this, give a description of use case relationship for a, give the general guidelines for a use case relationship. So you have a guidelines for use case sequence and activity, and similarly again you have a guidelines for use case relationship sequence model and advanced activity diagram. So don't get confused between these two concepts, because the guidelines for use case relationship is different from a general guidelines for representing a use case. Both are different. So this guidelines represents how to when we need to use a inclusion, when we need to use a extension and the generalization. That is how we are how to represent or when to use these concepts. Okay, so the first you guidelines for using the use case generalization is the use case comes with the several variations. That means you can have an added behavior or a common behavior. So whatever the common behavior are there, so those can be represented with respect to the parent use case or a child use cases. So we need, when we are trying to represent a when we are trying to represent the use cases, what we need to do? We need to fragment the behavior. That means where to use this particular behavior. So whether it will be used for all the child cases, child use cases, or whether it is the abstract use cases, that has to be taken care. Next thing is use case inclusion. That means when we need to use a inclusion or includes relationship in the use cases. So if a has been known that the use cases are a small piece of functionality that are represented for a particular system. So we need to identify whether these include relationship is being included in a original use case or not, whether to be included or not. That means you cannot use inclusion, extend, and a generalization. Always we need to know whether it is in what type of what is the type of a system, whether this system should be included or not. Next is use case extension. In a use case extension, what we are trying to use, what we are trying to have is, so we need to identify what are the different features that can be extended. So in what way the features can be added. So whether whatever the features that has been added with respect to the extended relationship, whether these information is being tested or not. Next, we have a include relationship. So in a include, the difference between a include and a extend relationship. Why we need to use a include relationship or a extend relationship? So both are being represented as a small piece of information for a particular use cases. But here what happens? It depends upon a configuration of a system, in what way we need to represent the system. So when we want to have a additional behavior of a system, then what we are using, we are trying to use a extend relationship. So as we have seen with respect to the diagram, here we are using the additional behavior. In a trading short, we have a short sale. So this is called short sale or a marginal trading. So these are called as a added additional behavior. That means what? When you say a trade stock, either it can be a buying or a selling of a stock. So it can be a marginal trading, means so within a particular stipulated time or a stipulated price, the customer is trying to sell all his stock. That includes a marginal trading. So that is how we are trying to represent the use case behavior. Do you have any doubts in these three concepts, extend, include, and generalization? Any doubts? Just reply, anyone? Shall I move on? Okay, next we have a procedural sequence model. So this is an advanced concept of a sequence modeling. In a sequence modeling, we have seen how to represent the object. The objects are represented as a lifeline, right? And the messages, the operations are represented in a form of a messages which are being communicated from one object to the another object. So that is how we are trying to represent a sequence diagram. When we represent this sequence diagram, there are two different types of objects. So one we call it as a passive object, and one more we call it as a active object. So how do we define whether, or how do we denote the passive object or an active object? So here you can see three different objects, right? One is a transaction, customer table, and a rate table. So these are the three different objects. Okay, you can see here the customer table and the rate table are called as a passive object. So why these two objects are called as a passive object? So how do we differentiate between a passive and active objects? So whether these objects are really needed, that how we are going to represent the, those are represented or identified based on a communication of the object. So here you can see in a transaction, so from the beginning, the transaction object is an active. So how do you say that this object is an active? So you can see here the entire communication. So it has a small rectangle box. So this rectangle box denotes that throughout the transaction or throughout the interaction, this particular object is in an active state. That means this rectangle box denotes whether the object is in an active state or a passive state. Okay, so when it comes for a transaction, okay, so while making a trading, the system want to compute the commission. What is the commission of a brokerage system? So it has to calculate the commission for the brokerage system. So it will invoke the transaction. So based on the number of transaction and per price for per transaction, it will calculate the commission for a brokerage system. Okay, so when it calls the compute commission, so this object will be invoked. So once this object is being invoked, so what happens? This transaction table will ask for a service level. That is, it will go to the customer table. So it will ask for whatever the services that has been provided. So depending upon a, it will call for a service level. So it will access the service level. So when it calls a service level operation, so what happens, this customer table, you can see here, the dotted lines. Are you able to see the diagram? Whether the diagram is visible? Sunil?
Yes, ma'am, we are getting.
Yeah. Okay, till the operation is invoked, what happens? This customer table is in a passive state. That means what? When there is no communication, when there is no object is being invoked, or when no messages is being transmitted from one object to another object, till then the objects will be in a passive state. So once this customer table is invoked with respect to the service level, when it gets a message, so what happens? This customer table object will become in an active state, and it will return back what is the service level. So it will reply back to the transaction. So here what happens, you can see at this particular period of time, so this is a time of time span where the object is in an active state. So from this till here, maybe it can be in a seconds or it can be in a minutes. Okay, so within this time span, the customer table object is in an active state. Again, what happens? It will the transaction table will fetch the level. So once the level is being fetched by the transaction, now what happens? This transaction object will send a message, or it will invoke the operation calculate commission. That means it will take the level has a parameter, and transaction has a parameter with the operation calculate commission. So this operation will be invoked in a rate table. Okay, so what happens when the rate table, till then the rate table will be in a passive state, because no other communication is happening between is happening in a rate table. So till there, what happens? The rate table will be in a passive state. So once the operation is invoked, now what happens? That rate table will calculate the commission, and it will return back the commission to the transaction table, and later the commission will be printed or it will be sent to the system. So this is how we are trying to represent a passive object. That means the objects, till the object is being till the operations is being invoked, the objects will be in a passive state. So when the operations are invoked, or when the message is being communicated to the object, then the passive objects will be transformed to the active object. So that is how we are representing the sequence model. Okay, so here is one more example of a sequence diagram with respect to the transient objects. So in a transient object, here what we are representing, so the objects will consist both the active objects and the passive objects. Okay, so it is a mixed representation of active and a passive object immediately. So once the communication gets over, or once the transaction is being over, the objects will be transmitted or transformed into the passive state. So here what we have in this diagram, we have a three different objects. So A, B and C are the three different objects. Okay, so the object A is always being an active. Okay, so here what happens? This object A invokes the operation E, where this operation E consists of a argument C and D, which are available in a object B. So till few minutes, the object B will be in a passive state. Then once it receives a message, so what happens? This object B will become an active. Since this when it becomes an active, and when it want to execute this operation E, so this operation E consists of parameter C, and this parameter C is available with the object C. So what happens? This object B will invoke a object C, and it will ask for the object C to create an argument C. So what happens with respect to the argument, whatever the parameter that we have used, so it will try to create an object C with respect to an object C. Now what happens? The object C will create that parameter C and it will return back. Okay, so when it creates an object C, again this object C will have an operation E, will call for an operation, so which is available with respect to the object B. So here what happens, the operation E consists of a parameter M and N, so which we can call it as a subroutine or a sub functionality that are available within the object. So you can see a small rectangle box is constructed within a large rectangle box. So this is a sub functionality that has been invoked with respect to an object C. Now what happens? Whatever the operation E that has been invoked, so it will compute those operation and it will return back the result. That means what? From here to here within this time span, so what happens? It is executing it its order. It can be a commission, it can be a purchase, or it can be any other transaction. So that we call it as a execute order. So whatever the instructions are there, so those instructions will be executed within this time span. So once this operation is being executed, so what happens? This object B will return back the result to the object C. Again, what happens? This object C will return back this result back to the object B, and it will say it will return back to the object A. So further, no other communication or transaction is going to happen with the object A. So since no other communication is happening, so what we need to do? We need to destroy the object. That means what? Whenever the objects are not needed and when the object's transaction is being completed, what we need to do? We need to execute, or we need to destroy the object. Okay, so next, what we have? We have some guidelines to indicate the, we have some guidelines to represent a sequence model. So as I said, when we are trying to represent a use case model, so this use case model has a two different types of object. So one is an active object and one more is a passive object. Okay, so here what we need to do, first we need to know what is a active object and what is a passive object. So whether they are going to have with their own thread, and how the objects are being controlled with respect when the objects how the control is being taken care with respect to the active object and passive object. That is, when there is a transition from active to passive or passive to active, there should be a thread of control, and these thread of control should be identified, and whether there are any lacking between the thread of control should be identified. So that is what the main guideline of a procedural sequence model. And next we have a advanced features. So whatever the sequence diagram that we have represented, we need to identify, we need to represent in a form of a implementation details and how the system can be implemented. So these are the two different guidelines that we need to include. Next, what we have is a special constructs of a activity model. So when we are using the activity model, we are going to have a two different things. So one is a sending of a signal and one is a receiving of a signal. So what happens here? So here you can see the diagram with respect to the activity diagram, how the sending and receiving events is going to happen. So initially the system will execute the boot sequence. So once the system is being booted, so what happens? The system will accept the user login. So once the user login is being accepted, so it will go for a validation. So here you can see the signal is being represented with respect to the pentagon symbol. So this request validation is represented in a pentagon symbol. So where it will send the request validation to the network. So the sending of information will be represented with the dashed arrow, and it will be sent to the network. So once the request is being sent to the network, our system will be in a waiting state, and it will be in a waiting. It will be waiting for a response. So once it goes to the waiting state, what happens? The network will till then the network will be keep on validating for the user login credentials. So once it validates, it will get a confirmation. So the so this is what we call it as a receiving signal. So from the network we are trying to receive the confirmation. Once the confirmation is being received, now the system is ready to make a transaction. So this is how we are trying to represent a sending and receiving of a signals. So you have any doubt till here what we have discussed? Include, extend, generalization, active object, passive object. Yes, you can type your username in your chat box quickly.